Welcome back to Political Misfits on Radio Sputnik, where we bring you news, politics, and culture without the red and blue treatment. I'm Bob Schlaber here with Michelle Witte. Get ready to go against the grain. It's February, Thursday, the 25th. We continue to be in this. I had to go back to it, Michelle.
Sticking with the new style, Bob.
It's our trending Thursdays. I got to start a new trend here. I'll see if it picks up. We'll see if people on Friday, February 20th. Oh, I can't even do it myself. It's not going to catch. I already know. I'm bailing out of it, Michelle. It is Thursday, February 25th in the nation's capital. We're here with you for another hour. We got lots to cover here on Radio Sputnik, including McDonald's secretive fight to stop its workers from unionizing and the latest unemployment numbers. We'll also talk about medical debt in the time of COVID and if Joe Biden has a plan to cover those debts for you. We'll also, in our weekly Trends with Benefits segment, talk about the insane trend of the Clintons writing novels. This trend is not your friend. We got all of that, and we got Steve Grumbine, the founder and CEO of the nonprofit Real Progressives and Real Progress in Action and host of the podcast Macro in Cheese. Steve Grumbine, welcome back.
Hey, man, thanks for having me.
You know, Steve, I think our listeners' ears perked when I said we'd be bashing the Clintons, and now that they know you're here with us, I think we got them hooked.
Sounds good, man.
Bob, you're in for a treat. It's more than just the Clintons. I've got novels by, there's Gary Hart, Jimmy Carter. There's a bunch of stuff. It's gonna be exciting. But I have some questions for our guest, Steve, first, Bob, so you're just going to have to wait for a minute. Steve, I wanted to start our conversation today with a little a peek into what we decide we can and can't afford as a nation. And I also know that modern monetary theory really undercuts the whole concept of affording, you know, and what monetary streams and the rest of it. But I want to toss this out to you as a metaphor. Forbes yesterday had a story saying that after 15 years after the F-35's first flight, the U.S. Air Force is essentially admitting that the entire program is a failure, a $1.5 trillion failure. Because really, the Air Force originally wanted something like 1,800 of these new planes to replace its F-16 fighters and some other aging jets. 15 years into this program, it's got 250. It's basically saying, yeah, you know what? That's probably enough. Let's just start a whole new, brand new program to build a plane to, wait for it, replace its F-16s. Because the F-35 doesn't do that. It ended up this weird sort of monstrosity. And the argument in favor of the F-35 is basically that, no, this is a Ferrari. And you don't just drive your Ferrari to the grocery store. You save it for races. But, you know, honestly, I don't know if you want a car that can't drive in the rain to race in. And the F-35, I don't know if it's been proven to be very much good for anything. It's been plagued by technical trouble for years. And as this writer puts it, failure was basically baked into the program from the start by trying to make it do too much. And I interpret that as Lockheed Martin just going, oh, yeah, sure, we can work that in. That'll just be another $1 billion. Oh, yeah, sure, we can add that gadget. That'll just be another $2 billion. So that's been going on for years. Military contractors have been getting filthy, filthy rich off this plane. And it's actually pointless. And this is not our only high-profile military boondoggle recently. We had the Ford aircraft carrier procured in 2008. By last summer, it had cost $13 billion. That's the unit cost. That's one aircraft carrier. The whole program is going to be $37 billion. We already have, by many factors, more aircraft carriers than any other country in the world. It just doesn't make any sense to me. So on the one hand, we have these military programs that exceed the gross domestic product of entire countries. And on the other hand, we remain in the middle of a debate over the cost of sending people stimulus checks. And we have organs like the Washington Post consistently, once a week, I say, for the last couple of months, weighing in to say how terrible it is that $1,000 might go to someone who's not actively on the brink of death, and how we can't, we simply can't afford to give a $1,400 check to someone who makes, you know, $60,000 a year. And so, you know, since our economic discussions in this country remain bound by this idea that we are somehow dividing up a limited pool of resources, I wonder if you'd like to, you know, comment on that dichotomy, first of all, and then maybe tell us how, again, we need to expand our thinking into not understanding that we can't afford this because we have that, but we could reframe our entire understanding of our economy.
Well, you said a lot there. Let me just state for the record that I am a lefty, so there is a bias here, okay? Hmm. What I'm going to do is I'm going to put my righty hat on for just a second, and I'm going to say, see, this is a great thing. We're pouring money into this program. These people have jobs. They're making good money. They, in turn, are starting businesses. They, in turn, are spending that money into the community, and it's trickling right down to the very bottom. This is the way America was meant to be, trickle-down economic supply side. We're giving you the supply. We're waiting on the demand. That right there is that right-wing side to this. The yeah. left-wing side is saying, hey, we can do other things. We don't need to have an F-35, or we don't need to blow all that money into the military-industrial complex to keep the economy lifted up. We can make different choices. But here is the MMT angle, and I think this is really important. And the MMT, just to be clear, is not some ideology. This is the description of the way it is. So the take on this, I think, is more empirical than opinion. Mm. But the idea of being able to have an F-35 and at the same time have it completely unrelated whatsoever to being able to afford to give everyone retroactive survival checks going back to the beginning of the pandemic to present impose no constraint financially whatsoever mm-hmm. on either side of that. The issue with the F-35 isn't a matter of wasting dollars. It's really about terrible priorities. It's really mm-hmm. about giving money to the wrong people, if you will. And when I say the wrong people, when you already have so much, to leave the bottom with so little is absolutely immoral. I don't think there's any good case that could be made to say otherwise. Mm-hmm. So in the sense of looking at the F-35 and then looking at this new program and looking at the aircraft and looking at the unit cost and all that stuff, it's big numbers, really, really big numbers that have an emotional pull on people. Everyday life, you look in your bank account, you see $100 in there, you're like, oh, phew, I can get gas, right? That's mm-hmm. the equivalent of the average American's understanding of economics. So when you see these huge numbers, it's just like, you see, I mean, just audible sigh, like, wow, it's huge. But in fairness, it has nothing to do with our ability to afford either one of them, even the things we find detestable, even the things we find to be immoral and bad, we can yeah. afford them.
Yeah.
So the issue for one final thing, the issue for this really comes down to, are we diverting important resources? And resources is not money, by the way. Resources
right.
being equipment, labor, government resources, whatever, in terms of regulatory time spent with courts and so on. Are we wasting the real resources on things that are not in the people's best interest? And I think those are the kind of barometers that we should be looking at this, as opposed to how much does it cost?
Yeah, well, I'm glad you mentioned that, because, of course, you know, I'm looking at this and thinking, well, you know, I know exactly what Steve is going to say. He's going to say, like, these dollars don't matter, like the cost of this doesn't matter. But it's such a I was going to say useful, but it might be more honest to say it's an easy example to grab of, you know, we are talking about a government that's constantly saying we can't afford this thing that people want, you know, Medicare for all. We can't afford this relief that's going to go toward regular people. We can't afford whatever. And it's such an easy thing to reach for, to say, like, but you say we can afford these astronomical things, and to draw that contrast. And the point of course drawing that contrast is to get people to understand, one, that, you know, people who talk about not being able to afford something, even if they're doing it not in a MMT framework, but it, you know, with a different understanding of how our budget works, sure. they're being dishonest, right? And it's sort of like breaking down this sort of idea that is realistic, or that these people are not lying to you. But I think it is, you know, if we do want to get away from having economic conversations within a framework that's not correct, I think this idea of where are we directing resources is probably a much better way to frame it and talk about it. And that's, you know, materials, right? The mining, like what are everything we pull out of the earth comes at a cost. Why are we putting it into an F-13 instead of something that benefits society?
Yeah. You just earned hero status with that commentary. That right there is exactly, I mean, Stephanie Kelton frequently says, how are we going to resource it? Not how are we going to fund it? How are we going to resource it? Okay. Mm-hmm. Now, I want to say one other thing, too, that I think is oftentimes missed, because we get a lot of people to a certain point where we just are right now, where they see it. What we just stated, it's pretty obvious. But then they ask the question, why? And it's like, why is this even happening? And I think it's very important to understand that the fire sector, the finance, insurance, all that good stuff, right? Real estate, all of that right there is an industry. Same thing as the defense contracting is an industry. And so what government does is it has to take care of each of these industries, and it doesn't really matter what happens below there. And so the government has this religious belief that by funding industry, that it will trickle down to people. Well, let me tell you why they don't give direct payments to people. Because direct payments to people impact the fire sector's ability to predate on each of us. By eliminating the ability for them to be predatory, we eliminate their entire business model. And so the government it kind of hems and haws about helping the regular people, because if I give you health care, then all of a sudden, when the healthcare industry is trying to find a new way to turn a profit, it can't gouge us because the government is already absorbing it. The same thing with the checks. I mean, my goodness, hey, how else are you going to go to the bank and get a loan? They want you to take out a loan. Well, the only way you're going to take out a loan is if you're short on funds or you don't have enough to achieve whatever you're trying to do. So what are they going to do? They're going to go ahead and block us from getting that money so that we have to, in fact, patronize the Wall Street banks and loan companies and all these loan sharks. That's why you see 35% loans out there, because people got no choice and they know it and they're predating on us right now. Mm-hmm.
No, and I mean, you know, part of that, just that whole sort of spiel that I just went through is an effort to shift my own thinking, right? Because it is very hard to untrain yourself to be thinking about, your government finances in a different way than you think about your own household finances. So, you know, I find it useful. I like being able to talk through this stuff with you. And, you know, sticking on the theme of money going into people's pockets, the other fight that's unbelievably continuing on Capitol Hill is this debate about increasing the minimum wage. And, you know, you have Congresswoman Pramila Jayapal saying, you know, whatever the congressional parliamentarian says, and that we might get actually today, you know, we as a party made a promise to put money in people's pockets. We made a promise to raise this minimum wage, and we have to do it. And on the other hand, you know, you have Senator Joe Manchin saying, how about $11 an hour? Would that be okay with you guys? We have Kristen Sinema saying she opposes the increase entirely. We have Joe Biden signaling for a while now that this minimum wage increase isn't going to be part of the bill. And, you know, Steve, I thought Democrats came in saying they were going to fight like hell for this. They seem to be rolling over pretty quick.
Well, you know, you can't teach an old dog new tricks, and the Democrats are famous for rolling over, right? So I look at this as par for the course, but I want to stop this right here. Ayanna Pressley has pushed forward an MMT-laden job guarantee bill right now, and I know a lot of the people on the back end that are pushing for this. Now, I want you to understand why this matters. A job guarantee, by its very nature, sets the de facto minimum wage. So if you make the job guarantee $20 an hour with benefits, all of the other companies out there are going to have to meet or beat that price to hire people. And if their business model can't handle that, then they'll go out of business naturally. But the reality of this is that we are spending money directly to people through a job guarantee this way, avoiding all the handlers. And by doing that, what you've done is you've done a net infusion to the largest population in the country that has tons and tons and tons of pent-up demand. By having a demand-side approach to this, these people will then spend that money from their job guarantee back into the economy. This isn't trickle down, this is trickle up. Mm-hmm. And so by doing a job guarantee, it makes this whole $15 an hour minimum wage almost irrelevant, because that 15 is nowhere near enough. And by passing a $15 minimum, which isn't even, it still is a poverty wage, okay?
By
passing that instead of the job guarantee, what you've done is you've given those same Democrats that roll over like an old dog, you've given them the excuse to say, see, we've already helped the little people. We gave them this 15 per hour, and it's a buzzword. It fits nicely on a bumper sticker. But that job guarantee is absolutely transformational. So I think focusing on the $15 an hour is easy for people that don't want to think, and it's just, hey, 15 an hour, yeah, sure, go. But the reality is we could do a hell of a lot more, and we need to do a lot more, and that's why I think the federal job guarantee with benefits, you name it, is so much more vital. And believe it or not, it, because it's a counter-cyclical thing, when the economy tanks like it did during the COVID thing, those job guarantees, even though we couldn't leave our home, it would have fundamentally changed, because everyone would have been able to have a job, even during the pandemic. And so there wouldn't have been the horrible malaise that we have. We wouldn't be worrying about relief checks. We'd be worrying about, hey, what kind of job can you do from home during this pandemic?
Why do you think a jobs guarantee doesn't get as much attention as a $15 minimum wage? Is it, as you said, that it's just a slightly more complicated concept? Does it have something to do with Ayanna Pressley not being exactly the same kind of, I suppose, national figure that some other Democratic progressives are? What's the block there?
Well, so you got a couple things. Number one, you've got this weird religious fetish for a UBI going on. And the people that don't understand economics don't understand that a UBI is basically turning us into consumption units for Silicon Valley and sets the gig economy up and keeps us in precarity forever. Job guarantee, you've got to actually do a job. So Walmart can't subsidize their crap wages with your UBI. With a job guarantee, they can't do that at all. In order for them to hire you, they got to say, well, shoot, you're making 20 an hour on the job guarantee. We'll pay you 25 an hour. Oh, okay, Walmart, I'll come work for you now. You're not going to get me on a cheap. And so I think the businesses are all against it. I think a lot of, people that want to be able to maintain a discipline-type control over labor are against it. Because what it does is a job guarantee fundamentally shifts society away from fear and puts us into a more stable environment. This is a stabilizing program. And so precarity is what people that like to gamble, people that like to play the market, people that like to do these things like shorting GameStop, these people want to make money on things going wrong. They see by leveling out labor and making it so labor is no longer terrified, they take away so much of the opportunity for these swindlers and these fraudulent folks to come and predate on people through Wall Street and other things like that. So that's what I think is the problem. I think that it's an underlying subterfuge propaganda war that we've just got to keep pressing for and fighting for.
Yeah, I just want to throw out in part of the propaganda war. If people haven't seen the story, I mean, it just shows the nefarious acts of these major corporations. But a new article from Vice is called McDonald's Secretive Intel Team Spies on Fight for 15 Workers. The story from Vice reads, for years, McDonald's has internally labeled activists and employees working for the Fight for 15 campaign a security threat and has spied on them. McDonald's say that the work is designed to identify protests that could put crew and customers' safety at risk. Okay, McDonald's, I'm not buying that. The fast food giant secretive intelligent unit has monitored its own workers' activities, including by using social media monitoring tools and a team of intelligent analysts in Chicago and London to keep an eye on activities of activists and organizers around the world. Since its inception, McDonald's has publicly opposed the campaign's attempts to unionize workers and pay a $15 minimum wage. McDonald's has dedicated vast resources to paying lobbyists, top union avoidance lawyers, and its own staff to fight minimum wage increases proposed by the campaign. You know, Steve, all I can picture when I think of this story is like Ronald McDonald balding and turning into Pennywise from the movie It and luring union organizers into sewage drains in order to murder them. I mean, it's quite horrific. So that on top of the fact, you also have a former McDonald's CEO in 2016 blaming the Fight for 15 on the need then for McDonald's to automate more of its kiosks. So he's basically saying we can't afford these people. We're going to turn them all into robots because we're not making profit. And obviously the question is, well, how much profit are you making? McDonald's in 2019 made $6 billion in profit, and they generated over $21 billion in revenue. So, I mean, Steve, it's quite remarkable. This guy's got $100 bills falling out of his pockets and saying, ah, we just can't afford the workers. Let's automate them.
You know, let's talk about that funny term surplus value, right? I mean, this is all labor of somebody that is being spliced down so some capitalists can either pass on money to investors or pocket it themselves. And you realize that they've got very deep pockets because they make a huge windfall of profits. Okay. So I think that this is a lot of schadenfreude. I think people are genuinely starting to realize that if wages don't pick up fast, that no amount of government stimulus is going to keep the economy going. And this is one of those huge, you know, eyesores on America and really around the world, in that we are really run by global corporations like McDonald's who use these opportunities to really, you know, inject fear, people fighting against their own needs. It's really quite depressing. But I also believe that there is something. McDonald's has often served as kind of the employer of last resort. And so if you think about the government taking on the federal job guarantee by becoming the employer of last resort, what does that do to McDonald's? How are they going to get their burgers flipped? And so this is one of those interesting dynamics that you start to begin to understand why some business leaders might be opposed to a federal job guarantee, because they can't provide crap wages and they can't really basically make you feel lucky to be there. And so this right here is a real, it's just part and parcel with what we were talking about in the last little blurb, because I think the federal job guarantee still ends up being the answer here. And that is how you counterbalance McDonald's stranglehold over young workers and, you know, people that are desperate for work. That's how they get you. They predate on people's needs. So
yeah,
I think the job guarantee is the silver bullet once again.
Yeah. And, you know, one of those, I want to talk before we let you go about one of the most successful predation efforts, really, which is our health insurance system. And, you know, there is an aspect of the COVID relief legislation in the House right now that would make some changes to the way our healthcare system functions, at least temporarily. But rather than expanding Medicare, either temporarily or permanently, the Democrats bill in the House would increase subsidies to people buying insurance through ACA markets and expand eligibility for subsidized coverage, again, through the Affordable Care Act and the marketplaces that it's set up. But of course, that just means that money ultimately goes to the huge insurance companies that offer these plans. And this just happens to be something that these insurance companies have been lobbying for a long time, at least according to a story by Andrew Perez this week. Also, I just want to get into some of the details here so people can understand again how awful our healthcare system is. For individuals who aren't eligible for subsidies because they earn the astronomical amount of like $51,000 a year, their premiums would be capped at 8.5% of their income. So that is something they are doing for us, capping premiums at 8.5% of our incomes. That's to say nothing of deductibles, copays, drug costs, whatever. So we have, you know, the Daily Poster is attacking this from the left. Wall Street Journal today is attacking this plan on the right, saying that it's intentionally introducing more dysfunction into our healthcare system with the goal of arriving at a single payer system in the future, which cracks me up. We spent a lot of time on the show talking about Democrats fighting phantoms, but this is a instance of the Republicans very obviously doing that, because there's no way the Democrats want to set up, you know, expand Medicare for all or set up any kind of single payer system, because if they did, now would be exactly the time to do it. That's what people want. Instead, they are going to spend political capital and resource our existing healthcare system, which already, you know, continues to siphon money from people and just pass it upward toward insurance companies. So I just wonder if you wanted to comment on this debate right now and, you know, on once again, are Congress doing, instead of what so many people want, finding a way to send more of our resources toward huge health insurance companies?
Yeah, we're talking neoliberalism as per the use. This, once again, anytime the government seeks out business to be their vehicle for distribution in this way, they have set down the whole trickle down effect, right? And this once again is a boondoggle for the insurance industry. Medical communities don't like it. You see nurses fighting back against it. Everybody that's outside of the insurance industry or Wall Street, which likes to gamble once again, doesn't like the sure thing. The sure thing doesn't make money. It's the gamble that makes the money, right? And so this is once again just more of Biden protecting Obama's legacy and the pursuit of neoliberal public-private partnership type arrangements that just do not serve the people in the way that people think. It once again is absolutely a it was a bad plan when it was instituted, and all the hand-wringing aside, I mean, it was Mitt Romney's plan. It was a Republican Heritage Foundation plan to begin with, so let's not ever forget that, right? I think that this is probably just more of the window dressing that they're trying to put on to make the ACA seem palatable so Biden doesn't have his legacy be repealing what Obama put in. So I think this is really about protecting legacy.
I kind of want to ask Steve, just to sort of in a general kind of philosophical sense, I mean, some like the $51,000 being the cutoff for these subsidies, having premiums capped at 8.5% of your income, you know, there's, I wonder honestly if in this recovery that the Democrats really run the risk of allowing people to become too uncomfortable. Because I think it's pretty obvious, you know, they are trying, both major parties and sort of the our system of government as a whole is really trying to walk a line between making people so unhappy, so miserable, so uncomfortable that they don't have anything left to lose and start doing genuinely frightening things. And, you know, giving them just enough to placate them. And I don't know, man, sometimes I look at the relief bill that's coming down and I think, I don't know. I think you might've miscalculated. I feel like I don't know if this is actually going to placate people in the way you are expecting it to.
Well, so there's a movie, I recommend it. It's called Into the Wild. And Liam Neeson plays this guy in the Alaskan wild. The plane goes down and they're running from a pack of wolves. And there's this one guy that slips and falls down a little side of a creek. And he falls into the creek and he goes to the rapids and his foot gets stuck on a branch underneath the water. And if you look, the top of his head is above the water. That's the Democratic relief plan. His nose is below the waterline, though. He still can't breathe. And this is the standard Democrat approach to everything. And it's like, see, we gave you relief. What are you talking about? Of course we gave you relief. And the reason why this is a problem, and I'm just going to say this outright, we need to get away from means testing anything. Even those rich, nasty SOBs, give it to them. Because if you make it a right, if you give it to all, it can't be taken away. That's the beauty of Social Security. That's why you've seen it last forever. And every time they do these means-tested things, the left feels really good because, damn it, the right should never get that. The rich should never win. But it's a cheap win. It's a low-hitting win. And it doesn't really take into consideration that anything that low can be cut again and can be eliminated. And so this is par for the course. Means testing is an incredibly awful approach to governance and policymaking, and the Democrats are king of means testing. It's their whole strategy, unfortunately. So this is what you get. It's sad, but it's true.
Steve, no, I don't. Not to distract from your point whatsoever. The movie I think you're pulling for is The Gray there with Liam Neeson.
Yes,
Into the Wild. Also a fantastic movie.
Thank you. Yes.
I mean, Into the Wild, also really a great movie, again, about living with the environment and tapping back in and exerting, getting rid of all the capital that you're constrained by in your life. So The Gray and Into the Wild should be both on your movie watching list. You know, there's another movie I'm going to be watching this weekend. Steve Grimine, any guess on what I'll be watching this weekend?
Judas?
Nope. The new Untouchables, the Pecora Files.
Yes! Yes, this is a great episode too.
Yeah, I'm excited. There is two up right now. And if I could just ask, this is what everybody on the internet's talking about. Everybody that is on our YouTube channel hanging out with us right now, they want to hear more about the new Untouchables. Can you tell us a little bit more about the work you all did with Real Progress and the con, and looking back at history as well as the great financial crisis of more recently, 2007 and 2008?
Yes, I mean, we have identified a pattern. Not we. I mean, I'm the lucky guy that gets to ride along with these brilliant people. Patrick Lovell, Eric Vaughn, geniuses that put this together. Bill Black, of course, legendary Bill Black of the Keating Five, brought the Keating Five down. These are great people, brilliant people. Art Wilmarth, who will be on our podcast for Macro and Cheese next Saturday. All of these people are just stunningly brilliant. Richard Bowen, Mark Dan, I mean, Lori Noble, so many great people, Tom Murphy. And so what you're going to see is the inside track that you see in the docuseries, The Con. You get to hear the inside track, the stuff that didn't make it to the movie. You get to hear the behind-the-scenes stuff, and you get to start seeing the tie-ins. Most important, the tie-ins from yesterday into what's happening today. You get to understand that this elite control fraud hasn't gone anywhere, and that the economy is in dangerous place that backstops the criminal behavior of the wealthy while simultaneously leaving the poor to suffer, stealing their homes, stealing their pensions, stealing their lives. And folks, if you're not angry about this, you need to watch this the show, the new Untouchables, the Pecora Files. We're trying to get you, not us, you, involved to get excited and angry enough to push your elected representatives, to push your newspapers, to push your favorite media channels, to begin talking about what Ferdinand Pecora, the guy who took it, the fight during the Great Depression, took that to the criminal elements of the banksters back in the day when they let the economy completely fall apart. We need a new Pecora hearing, and that's what the whole goal of this entire series is to make Wall Street pay for destroying the lives of millions of Americans and people around the world, and using predatory behaviors to destroy people that are already too broke to survive, like poor minorities in these poor. It's an amazing set of stories. It is deep. It is very much investigative, and we've got whistleblowers that have lost their careers and that are eagerly telling their story. So I beg everyone, please take a listen to the new Untouchables, the Pecora Files. We're on Facebook, we're on YouTube, and we've got the podcast on our website. So if you come to our website, realprogressives.org, and go to the Untouchables under media, the new Untouchables, and you will find not only the video, but the audio. If you're one of those people that enjoys listening to a podcast while you're doing yard work or the dishes or whatever, it's a great opportunity to listen to it. The video part is really well done. Our video editors, Christina and Andy, have done just miraculous work. And Andy Kennedy has done great work with the audio as well. So please, 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 this is not infotainment, folks. I'm an activist, and I mean to try to stir a populist movement to bring down Wall Street, to bring these criminals to justice that inhabit our government, inhabit all of our institutions, and walk through this crazy revolving door from government back to private practice at Citi and JP Morgan and all that good stuff, and then right back to government again. We got to get these guys out. We got to out them. We got to put them behind bars.
That was Steve Grumbine, the founder and CEO of the nonprofit Real Progressives and Real Progress in Action, and the host of the podcast Macro in Cheese. Steve Grumbine, always appreciate your time and all the hard activism you do for all of us here in the United States and around the world. Steve Grumbine, thanks again for your time.
Thank you.